Before she got to see the screen. Oh, there she is. You can't see it on the screen though, but there's a rainbow.
Yeah,
I was
gonna say, where's rainbow?
Yeah.
Right.
Huh. Well, there was a rainbow there.
She's not pointing at nothing.
She absorbed it.
So that's what we want to talk about today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you that you do make us more than conquerors through the blood of Jesus. Father, the things that the world offers us as rewards pale in comparison to the values that you have given us if we follow the way of your Son. Lord, you give us so many precious promises, so many precious victories, so many directions of fulfillment and contentment and joy if we are surrendered to your will and to your way. Lord, as a person who was once lost, I remember well the struggle of trying to resist your will. The struggle of thinking that if I went the way that you had asked me to go, it would be dry and plain and boring and oppressive and almost feel confined, like I would be in prison. Little did I know that with the rushing of your Spirit, Lord, there is more freedom than anything the world could offer. Little did I know then in that time, God, that your direction was a way of peace, of love, and of joy that passes the understandings of the world. What a great deception the evil one has placed upon the minds of men and women throughout the world in order to keep them from turning to you. I pray, God, that we would find you in your richness and your glory, and that we would thirst for you more and more as we learn how not to quench your Spirit, how to drink of the water freely and experience you in a way that is so liberating. We love you. We ask for your presence. We pray that you would just take over, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You know, I kind of prayed it, but the rewards and victories in Christ are much greater than the rewards that the world awards to us. It seems so much like if you get what you want to attain in this world, it's not long till you think that that wasn't enough. Or now I need to go on to the next thing. I got to find the next thing that will give me pleasure or victory or accolades or fame or finances or comfort or whatever it is we chase after in the world. It seems like if you indeed are able to attain it, you are left with a hunger to try and enlarge that or expand it or get more of it. But in Christ, it's not like that. In Christ, the fulfillment comes, and it's eternal, and it's rich, and the waters of blessing are as deep as you're willing to swim. And so I am very grateful for my salvation, and I hope you are for yours as well. This morning, I want to talk a little bit about this more than conquerors concept, and it comes from Romans, and Ty read it well, but I'll read it again. Romans 8, 37 through 39. It says, "We are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." So here in this passage, Paul refers to the word conquerors. Some of your versions may use some other word, but and it says more than conquerors. And so he kind of uses a word that kind of imposes the concept that it's greater than a victory. It's greater than winning. It's something beyond that. You know, when I count my victories in Christ, and I was reflecting on them a lot this week, and realizing that none of the victories I have in Christ came without opposition. It's been a long road for me. I'm not that old, maybe some of you say, that are older than me, but in my road, I've encountered with everything that I chased after with Christ, somebody would step up and say, "You shouldn't," or "You can't." Everything I sought after in him was brought to me with opposition. And it's not that I sought after worldly pursuits. It's been the God things that I was looking for in my life. The God places, the God jobs, the things that seemed to be spiritual and seemed to be the right choices were the things that I faced the greatest opposition for. When I sought worldly pursuits, actually, it was then that the crowd would say, yeah, do that. That sounds like a great idea. Because that's the way the evil one works in this world. The opposition to good is there and strong, but the opposition to bad choices is very welcoming. They want you to make those choices. So the journey trying to seek the way with Jesus has always come with opposition for me. In the beginning, the opposition showed their colors and their side quickly. It was obvious when I first started following Christ and my best friend from childhood, from 3 years old, was like, I don't like you as a Christian. It was very clear what the sides were. They were black and white. And so in the beginning of the testimony of my own life, I saw that the colors and the sides were very quickly evolving into black versus white, dark versus light, freedom versus slavery, lost versus saved, truth versus lie. But as the journey continued, the waters got foggy sometimes. And sometimes the opposition to goodness and to following the Holy Spirit would come from those within the ranks.
That's right.
And it became very difficult sometimes to discern the opposition because people who claimed to be spiritually minded had infiltrated the camp, so to speak, and were spies for the enemy. They weren't really out for pursuing the godly choices in life. And maybe you can relate to some of those things. But here Paul has told us in Romans that we are more than conquerors. The concept I think of that is easiest to relate to this word, which we're going to learn a little bit about, it's the word Nike. You like that? You all thought you didn't know Greek. This morning you know Greek better than you realize. But in this particular word, he abbreviates it with a prefix that means to go beyond. It's Hooper Nikoman, which means we're like super Nike. It's like we're going way beyond the victory here. And when Paul begins to convey this, he's saying that when you're on the side of light, when you've stepped into sonship or daughtership with Christ, you have been given victory because his love for you is on you. And neither height nor depth nor angel nor power or ruler or demon or past or present or anything in all creation can separate you from that love. He's positioned you to victory. He's positioned you to conquer. He's positioned you as a born-again person to win. And, you know, we love winning. Everybody loves winning. Except that sometimes winning is for ourselves, and sometimes winning is for what God wants. And when we get on the winning team, which is God, in the end, he's the winning team. You know, some think, wow, he got hammered on a cross, and some think God is dead, and some think the Bible doesn't have the impact it used to have. Some think that Christianity is on the way out. Some think that because doors are closing all over the valley in some of these little churches, that means Christianity is taking some hard blow. No, I'm here to tell you that Jesus is winning. His church will have its spotless gown. It will be without spot and wrinkle, and he will present to God the Father in the final day his bride. And it'll be marvelous, and he is the winner. And we're going to learn a little bit about that. But he won. He began this streak of winning long ago, and he had his plans from the beginning. And there are scriptures in the Bible that kind of convey this that sometimes we may miss because of translations and language. So that's the journey I want to go on. I want to go on the Nike journey with you a little bit to talk about our victory in Christ. I want to pause and digress to talk about an acquaintance of mine. His name is Nick Bordieri. And Nick was the general manager for aspects of Nike for 21 years. He was the general manager for all of Asia for a while. That meant Taiwan and the Philippines and all those places. And he was like the general manager for South America. He started Nike in Argentina and different places like that. A very successful man in the corporation. But by his own testimony, and he's easy to find, you can look him up on Facebook, and he's pretty friendly. You could probably friend him if he has any friend spots left, you know, because Facebook only allows you 5,000. But he'll tell you quickly that he let go of that life, that pursuit of the world's victories, and found Jesus. And he began to learn and see that the true victories of life, the true overcoming, the true refreshment, the true rest, the thing that we seek the most in the worldly pursuits we seek, the things that are underlying the values or the jewels, the crown, when men pursue awards, accolades, victories, accomplishments, services, things that get them praise or finances or health or all kinds of things that the world offers, the heart of what is deep down in there is Christ. But the world kind of puts a different coating on it. It's like making M&Ms with rocks in the middle instead of peanuts. And so Nick discovered this, and he abandoned all of his career and became a minister. And the first thing that I remember him doing in his run back to Jesus was opening an orphanage in like the Philippines or someplace. Was it the Philippines, Davian? Do you remember?
Cambodia.
It was Cambodia. But he's an example to me, and I like to bring him up just because of where he used to work, of somebody who didn't let anything stand in his way to make a radical decision. If he had wealth to give up, he's an example of that. If he had family to oppose, he has family. He was an example of that. If he had an army of people opposing his decisions in Christ, he was a person that I could look to and see and that he did that. But Jesus uses this word that comes from that word Nike. You know, Nike chose their shoe brand based on this whole concept. There's a Greek god that's actually named after it, and we're not going to spend any time talking about her. But we're going to be talking about victory. We're going to talk about being a conqueror. Someone who overcomes. And Jesus ultimately uses a phrase from a quote in Isaiah chapter 25:8, and Paul reiterates it in 1 Corinthians 15:55, and that's when Jesus raises from the dead, he conquers the grave. This is Nike, this is Nikao, this is Christ going in and showing that even death has no hold on him. That in Christ there is no death, there is no grave, there is nothing that has bars on him. And so when he was crucified and died and rose from the dead, he exemplified for us that even the grave, Hades, had no hold on him. And he let us know quickly from the beginning that all authority in heaven and earth had been given to him, and what he had he was going to distribute to his own. And that means no death or grave has a hold on you. And so how do we live in that level of victory, and how do we know when we're experiencing the victory of Christ, when we see pain in our lives, when we see destruction in our lives, when we see empty dreams fall to the ground, when we see things happen that we wouldn't think were God's will, and how do we get to the place where we would understand that we are overcomers and that we are victorious when we have a perception that is the perception of God instead of the perception of this world? How do we get there? In that Corinthians passage, in its bulk, it says, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. It is sin itself that robs us of our victories. You know, when you're depressed, when you're down and out, when you're defeated, when things are not going well. More than not, it's sin. And it may not always be your sin. It could be your neighbor's. Could be your spouse's. Could be your brother's. But sin comes in to destroy victory. You know, the Nike conception, the Greek conception, if you would, of victory was something that had permanence. The Greeks in the early days believed that true victory, this word for victory, was complete victory. And so it was never achieved by man or woman, because man's victories are always temporal. It's like the easy concept. If you're the fastest runner in the world, you're that for a while. If you're the greatest at anything in the world, you're that for a while. And so in the Greek mindset, it was that only a god could attain to victory, which was eternal. And so when God moved in the days of a time when the Greeks had a power over the world, kind of like America has the power of the world today. That time was specifically chosen so that God's word would go forth in a climate and a time in which we could observe things and learn things and fulfill his prophecies and understand things. And in this time, Jesus, when he's declared to have grabbed the victory, the Greek concept is only a God could do that. We just got done with a series in Ephesus, looking at the church in Ephesus, and we kind of concluded, if you did catch it, if you didn't, it's okay. We concluded in what the message was that Jesus spoke to the churches, the seven churches in Revelation, and the specific message that was spoken to the Ephesians. He said to them, you've walked away from your first love. You know, he's really going after them. You got everything lined up here, but your heart's not with me anymore. And you've left it. You've abandoned it. In some translations, you could even say you've divorced your first love. Okay, and so here he is identifying their sin. And their sin is not one that's really very outward. It's an inward sin. You've detached yourself from the victor. You've detached yourself from the conqueror. All the works you're doing that are good works. He commends them for their works. He commends them for their lifestyle of Christianity. He says, I commend you for what you're doing, but you've detached yourself for the reason why you do them. You've stepped away from the motivating force that's supposed to cause you to do those good works. You've almost like embraced what is good, but somehow you've lost your love life with me. But at the end of every letter to the churches in Revelation, there's seven churches listed there, he ends them all with a message to the overcomers. And he says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. To him, it's the same word, this Nike word, it's in there. To him who overcomes, to the conqueror. Well, there's something good about this. It means that even in such a depressing message from the Lord, that you've left your first love, that you've abandoned me, that on the backside, there are people that are going to hear the message. It's going to sink in. They're going to receive it, and they're going to overcome. They're going to conquer, they're going to press through, and they're going to love their Lord again with fierceness and ferocity that may pale their relationship in the past, because overcomers are amazing. Are you an overcomer today? You know, he throws this at the end of every one of the churches in Revelation. And most of us who've been around church long enough, remember there's one church we all don't want to be, and that's the lukewarm church, right? And that's the message to the church in Laodicea. But we see in all these passages that he has a message to the overcomers of every church situation, every congregation. And he has a message to every congregation that within you are those who will have the victory and those who will overcome. As we see in the church to Ephesus, he said that they would be given to the access to the tree of life. To the church in Smyrna, he says, you shall not be hurt by the second death. To the church in Pergamum, he says, I'll give you the privilege to eat manna and have your name written in stone. To the church in Thyatira, he says, you will rule the nations and have the morning star. To the church in Sardis, he says, you'll be clothed in white and named in the book of life. Man, that's the one I want the most. I want my name in the book of life. The church of Philadelphia, which has the reputation of being the strongest church, you will be made a pillar in God's temple with God's name written on it. And to the church in Laodicea, he says, to him that overcomes, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. Again, that word overcome, to be an overcomer, that's all embedded in there. No congregation is left without a promise to its overcomers. So I want to look at another passage in Revelation, in Revelation chapter 21. And it's a kind of a familiar passage for some of us. You'll hear it as that when you hear it, but maybe not so familiar to some others. Revelation chapter 21, verse 6, it says, "He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of water of life. He who overcomes will inherit all of this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son.'" And pause there for a second. He says to the overcomers, you'll get it all. To the victors, you'll get it all. But you have to overcome. We're going to find in the very next verse that you cannot go ahead and decide that I'm going to quit. I'm going to lay down. I'm going to resign. I'm going to abandon a ship. I'm not going to be part of this journey anymore. I don't want to be part of this. Lord, your way is too difficult. I'm too tired. It doesn't make sense to me. It's not what I thought it was. And we abandon ship. And he's saying you can't stay there. You have to be of the party of the overcomers. Because he says in the very next verse, but the cowardly. And that's what a non-overcomer is. It's a coward. It's a person that's not willing to pay the price to win. Now, if you have the world's definition of win, then that didn't make sense to you. But if you have God's definition of win, it does not include the coward. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic art, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. He makes it very clear. If you're not an overcomer, you're going to the second death. And if you'll remember, that was the promise to the church in Smyrna. If you overcome, you will not be hurt by the second death. I want to look at basically six passages besides this one. And they're up here on the screen. And I think they'll burn in your heart better if you follow along. The first one I want to look at is 1 John 5. And I'll tell you here at this point, there's a spirit I'm battling against. It's a spirit that says, I can't get the victory over this. It's a spirit that says, I've tried and tried and tried a million different ways, and I guess I just have to put up with this sin in my life. And it wouldn't say it this way, but it's simply saying, I cannot repent. But that's not scripture. That's not what Jesus gave us. That's not the Holy Spirit. Of course you can't repent in the flesh. In your fleshly self, in your own strength, you absolutely can't repent. Matter of fact, all you can do is make it worse. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, which he distributes freely upon those who cry out to him, begging him for it, he is ready to give it to them. He gives you the power to overcome. So we're going to see that. In 1 John 5, 4 and 5, actually I'm going to start with 3, 1 John 4, 3. This is love for God, to obey his commands. I started with 3 for a reason, because that spirit I'm talking about that opposes victory doesn't like this verse. Because this verse says, a person who loves God must obey his commands. And a person who wants to walk in defeat says, no, I can't obey God's commands. I'm going to walk in defeat because I can't repent. I've tried a million ways and God accepts me the way I am. But this scripture says it clearly. Your love will force you into obedience.
Yes.
When you experience God's love is when your love turns on. It's interesting. You don't really love God till you understand his love for you. And when you got a proper aspect of his love, which is not a license to sin, it's a fatherly love, it's an intimate love, it's a love that wants to bring you along to the victory. When you start to get more mature in God's love, then your own love for him gets stronger. And the more you understand God's love, the stronger your love for him gets. And the stronger your love for him gets, the more you want to please him. And it drives you to victory. It's amazing. It's my life. This is my life. I've sat in meetings at times, and I remember one time when the Holy Spirit's presence came and we were singing, and we are standing. It was we're standing on holy ground, whatever that song is, this is holy ground, this is holy ground, blah, blah, blah. And I just thought, man, it started to feel like I was standing on holy ground, and I kicked my shoes off. You know, because Moses, you know, when he got encountered the bush, and the bush is burning, and it's not burning up, and he realizes God, and Moses is there kind of wondering what in the world is this bush experience, and God speaks out from the bush and says, Moses, you're standing on holy ground. Take your sandals off. What made the ground holy? Was it the bush? Was it the desert? Was it the building? It was the presence of God. And so I was feeling that, and I kicked the shoes off, and then all my sins flooded into my head. And all my failures. And I thought, you know, I don't even deserve to be standing on this holy ground. And I stepped back from the worship and got away from it. Because I couldn't come to grips with God's love in that moment. And when you can't come to grips with God's love, you can't come to grips with his forgiveness. And when you can't come to grips with God's forgiveness over you, then you can't forgive yourself or others for that matter. And if you can't forgive yourself, you become your own wall against the deep relationship that he wants to bring you in. He is a sanctifier. The number one gift of the Holy Spirit is not any of the miraculous powers. The number one gift of the Holy Spirit is to make you holy. That's what he's been called to do, to make you holy. Why? Because God wants to meet with you. He wants to be with you. He wants to be one with you. He took away that wall that separated you, sin. And so here he says, and his commands are not burdensome. And I'll speak to you because I can speak to myself. And I know that when his commands are burdensome to me, it's because they're heavy at that point because I've slipped a little ways off the path with him. When his commands get burdensome, they're either not his commands, but in this passage we're talking about his commands. So they're either not his commands at all, and we put ourselves under an unnecessary yoke of rules and traditions of men, or we've slipped out of the Holy Spirit's presence enough that it's heavy to obey what God wants us to do. God, that seems so difficult. You know, when love is strong, nothing's difficult. When you're two little lovebirds in a relationship with somebody and you're a couple, nothing was difficult. People could speak negative to your relationship. They could say, you guys will never make it. And that was fuel. When they said you couldn't, that's when you thought, I can. And that's what happened to me. I opened this message up with the fact that all my life, as I sought the good things in my life, if I sought the things that I thought were holy, as I pursued the things I felt the Holy Spirit driving me to, there were always people there to stand by me and say, you shouldn't do this. This is a bad choice. Don't go that way. And that was fuel. Because I thought, you know what? This is not about you and it's not about me. It's about a love relationship between me and my God. And what you've given me is the persecution and the fuel that I need to drive me to do the exact thing that I need to do. And so his commands and his burdens weren't burdens. His yoke was easy and his burden was light. And when Christ's yoke is not easy for you and the burden is not light, it's because, you know, I don't know if y'all know about the yoke. Most of you should know, being that we all grew up around this farm area. But the yoke on the back of the two creatures, if it's not equally yoked, if the creatures aren't carrying it right, then it becomes a burden to one of them or both of them. And it damages them usually because the yoke will be at different heights or it'll kink it and go to the left or the right and there'll be injuries involved on the animals. There needs to be an equal yoking. And so when Jesus' burden is not light and his yoke is not easy, it's because there's something wrong with your yoking. And it ain't his. We've gotten off pace, gotten ahead of him. We're falling behind him. We're trying to lift too much of the load on our own. We're thinking we don't have to lift any of the load. Neglect. But he says it's burdens, you know, when you're in the Spirit, when you're in there with Christ, when you're down in there and your love relationship is rich, he says his commands are not burdensome. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. Here it is. Everyone born of God, everyone who's born again, overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. So it's not talking about overcoming your faith. It's saying, what is the thing that helps us to overcome in the world? What is the thing that gives us the victory? It starts with your faith. Faith. And some of us have been damaged so long and hurt so many times. It's not that we don't have faith that God could do it. We don't have faith in ourselves. And I'm not saying you need to have faith in yourselves. You need to have faith in God, ultimately. But you faith is a place at which you believe that you're accepted to do it. When Peter sees Jesus coming as a phantom, walking on water, and he's trembling with fear, and the Spirit says, "It is I, don't fear." He says, "If it's you, Lord, tell me to walk on the water and come out to you." And he steps and he walks on the water for a moment. It took Peter's faith to do that. It took his ability to think that Christ would accept him to do that. Some of you have beaten yourself down by listening to the devil so long in your own defeats that you won't step out because you're not worthy. You're not an overcomer. You're not victorious. And there's nothing you've shown that you could conquer in your life because you're a failure. And that's what you've listened to. And that's not what Christ has given you. Because in the flesh, we're all failures. Without Christ, everything that I just said is true. But with Christ, with the Holy Spirit in you, you are a conqueror. You're a victor. And more than that, you're more than a conqueror. I like to think of the runner's race. And there's a tape stretched across it. When he's running those laps and he's getting near it and he knows he's going to break the tape, he doesn't stop. He runs through at the same pace that he has been running that whole race, and he breaks that tape and he excels the finish line because he's more than a conqueror. He's not just going to win the race. He's going to plow right through the finish line. And that's the blessing. That's the gift of God for every Christian. Well, you say, what about my failures? What about my insuccesses? Mindset. What the world calls winning sometimes would be better if you lost. What the world calls success sometimes would be more godly if you failed. What the world calls victory for Christ sometimes is loss. Jesus understood this principle, and discovering it is amazing because, you know, in Christ, sometimes he does want you to have a parallel vision that exemplifies not only the victory in the world, but victory in the Spirit. Other times he wants you to go ahead and take the loss in the world, but it's victory in the Spirit. And that's why it's so important to get in tune with the Spirit and to understand the Spirit and listen to the Spirit and understand that the Holy Spirit is on a whole different game board than the demonic, devilish, evil world that we live in. Skipping over, if you have an open Bible, you'll see in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. He says, "You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them." He is speaking about the demonic spirits. He's speaking about the spirits that speak against Christ. He's speaking about anything demonic or evil that doesn't get on the path with Christ. And he says, "But you, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world." When Christ comes to live in your heart, you have now inside of you the victor. He can't fail. Christ doesn't fail. Christ doesn't sin. And when he is in you, he's greater than anything this world could bring against you. This is interesting. Speaking of these other people, these people that John is addressing, he's talking about false prophets and people that are really not on Christ's side. He says, they are from the world, and therefore they speak from the viewpoint of the world. And the world listens to them. The world listens to the world. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us, but whoever is not from God does not listen to us. It's the black and white team. It's the separation of forces. And when you're with God, your ears are open to God's word, and you listen to God's word. And the team is obvious because my sheep hear my voice and they obey. Amen. And when they're not listening, or if even you're not listening, then you're off the track. And if the crowd's yelling at you saying, yeah, 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 and it's the voice of the world, then you've walked right back into the voice of the world. And you've put yourself right back in a place where you're going to be commended by the world or rebuked by the world according to the world's standards, the world's idea of what morality is. And that's not salvation. Whoever is not from God does not listen to God. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. It's that easy. Listen to this, and you must be positioning yourself closer to God. Reject this, find all your excuses, twist this, say this isn't applicable, work on this, just keep confusing this. Then you're in the gray water. You're at least in the gray water, if not all the way in the murky depths of complete deception. And this is why this is so important. He left it for us to study, to understand, to grow in. Romans 12:21. I love this one. So that last tool, the tool that we learned from those passages about how to walk in the Spirit and how to be overcomers, the ingredient that I grabbed out of those verses was one, faith. Okay. When we get here to Romans 12:21, this is an interesting one because it gives us another tool. And I'm going to start at 12:19, so you just understand the tool right off the bat. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. When you become the avenger, when you take revenge, you take God's honor of the whole principle, you reap what you sow. You step into somebody else's life and you say, I am going to be that person's judge, and you strip them God's honor of dealing with that person's heart. And what happens is you take revenge, and that person's mind is not on God. And they begin to look at you as the evil one and get angry, and it compiles upon compiling, and it gets layer after layer, and it creates bitterness and hatred, and it does not bring life. But God's discipline, God's revenge, God's wrath even brings life. That when you let God deal with some people, there's a chance for rebirth. But when you take it in your hands completely to be God's instrument of wrath, and you take revenge on these people that have hurt you, you strip God of his honor as judge. And he tells us plainly, don't do that. And you're like, well, what about enemies? He gets in there strong. He says, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. Wow, that's just not what we want to do. When I have been hurt by someone, the last thing I do in my mind, in the flesh, is think, I want to bless them. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals on his head. And we can teach a whole thing on that, but I won't. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the principle. If you want the victory, you're not going to get the victory by repaying evil with evil. You get the victory by giving good to evil. It's what Jesus did for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We are evil. None of us deserves salvation. None of us deserves what God has given us. None of us deserves a single day, a single breath. There's nothing we deserve. We can't go to the judgment seat and say, God, you treated me unfairly. You just didn't see it from my perspective. And so as God has given you goodness, as he has demonstrated giving you goodness, though you are evil, how could we not do the same thing? You want victory in your life? Start being good. Not just to those you love, but to those who it hurts you to love. In Luke 11, 21 through 22, Jesus tells a story, and I'm kind of speed through this one, but you got the verses. I want you to, if you care, look them up sometime. But Luke 11, 21, 22, Jesus in the midst of being accused that he's casting out demons by the power of Beelzebub. And this God, Beelzebub, is where we get the book, The Lord of the Flies. Because in Hebrew, Baal was a god, a false god, and Zevuv. In Hebrew, they love to name things after the sound they make. Zevuv, 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 Zevuv. Beelzebub. It gets transliterated as Beelzebub for us, but it's Hebrew for the Lord of the Flies. And so Jesus is here casting out demons and delivering people, and he's doing a great work. And they say, Jesus is doing this great work through the power of the devil. And he says, you know what? If that's the way you think, you go ask the people that do the same thing I'm doing whether they think the way you think. Go find someone else that has done what I've done and ask him if I'm operating in the spirit of Beelzebub. It's a fruit tester. But in the process of that, he gives an illustration about a guy, and he says, you know, this guy, he does everything he can to keep his house from being robbed. He does everything he can to protect his family, his home, his property. And he says, you know, if one that comes in that is stronger than him, he will overcome him. And whatever armor the guy trusted in will be taken from him. And so the point here I want to grab here is that the armor you trust in, what is your armor? What gives you security? What anchors you in? What protects you in this journey? If it's your wealth, it will be taken from you. If it's your adoration of family, it'll be taken from you. If it's your job, you think that's where all your security lies, it'll be taken from you. If it's your health, one day it will be taken from you. The only armor that a Christian can wear has been mentioned today already in Ephesians chapter 6. And that's the armor of God. That's the only armor that you can rely on. That's the only armor that stands against the strong one and the enemy and the devil. It's the only armor. And Jesus goes on after this passage that you may indeed get the place wiped clean, but if you don't fill it with the Holy Spirit, that demonic spirit will return with seven others. And the battle you'll face will be seven times harder than the battle you face today because you relied on the wrong armor. You made your victory through your own strength. Yeah, you got the house clean for a moment. You figured out by your own methodology, your own way to be strong and to accomplish what you wanted to accomplish, and you got there. And indeed, it may have been even something that God wanted you to accomplish, but you did it in your own strength. And by doing it in your own strength, you lose it. And your situation will be seven times worse than it was. John 16, 33, Jesus says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. He says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In Christ you may have peace. In Christ you may have victory. In Christ you can overcome. In Christ you can see these wins instead of losses. In the world, you're going to have trouble, he says, but take heart, I have already won. And we'll end with Revelation chapter 12. John says, Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, Now has come the salvation and power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short. In the demonic world, they understand they're under a time clock. And so they're on a rampage. The forces of evil are on a rampage to destroy anyone who comes close to being an overcomer. There's a real battle going on in the spirit realm. And the battle is, we want failures, and God wants overcomers. The world wants failures. We love an underdog. You ever want to make a movie and make millions? Make sure you got an underdog. Start with a failure, make him a winner, and then the next episode, make him a failure again. It's every movie we watch, almost, except for Little House on the Prairie. How did they overcome? They overcome with the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. What's a testimony if it has no victory? A Christian who says, you know, I'm a Christian, but you couldn't tell it by any way that they live. The power of Christian testimony is amazing. I always hate confessing sins in front of my mom. You guys probably won't get as many confessions. But when I was a little kid, I stole a lot. I'd sneak into my mom's drawers, my dad's drawers, my sister's drawers. I was one of those kids that just kept on stealing stuff, coins. I think I spent a lot of my dad's coins that were actually worth something, thinking they were just worth the face value. One of the very first things God convicted me of is stealing. So ferociously did he convict me of this stealing that I gathered up everything I could, and what I could return, I actually returned. I broke some hearts. I'm sorry about the coins, Mom. I couldn't return them. They were gone. But I returned some things. I remember returning something to one of my then best friend and how he was hurt. He was like, I can't believe you did that. And I said, I'm so sorry. And here it is back. And please forgive me. And I dealt with it the way I could. And there were other things I couldn't return. There was just no way to bring them back. And I hiked up in the mountains, and we had pack rats up there where I grew up. And some of you don't know what pack rats are, but they're a big rat, and they like things. They're like the crow in a lot of movies. They like the shiny things. Well, pack rats are like that. You take anything kind of strange or different, and they build these huge nests, of, like pyramid-shaped, in the middle of bushes. And they usually have a lot of different entrances. And they just gather stuff, and they take them down into their nest. And it's cool. You can read up on it online. It's really neat. And so we grew up in a land of pack rats, so I took everything that I knew that I had ever stolen. And I took it, and I put it at the opening of the pack rat's nest. And of course, he came and got it, and one by one, and one by one. I went back up there on an emotional time once to look, and there was nothing. My point, I've never stolen again. I can't even walk into a bank and take the pen with the bank name on it. And I'm not even thinking that's wrong. JB probably prints pens with his logo and doesn't mind if the customer takes them. The thought is that that's a form of advertisement. They're going to take the pen anyway. I can't even take the pen or advertise for you. Because God completely gave me the victory over that. It wasn't in my strength. As a kid, I was just a little klepto. I'd steal anything. I can't take anything. Nothing. Because it's between me and my God. I could get away with it. I could steal a pen from a bank, they'd never know it. I could steal a lot of things, they'd never know it. But it's not between me and them. It's between me and my God. I realize how much he loves me and how much he delivered me and how much he gave me the victory in this area, and there's no way I want to betray that. That's the kind of victory we need in every aspect of our life. Lust, pornography, lying, cheating, hatred, bitterness, unforgiveness, or just the excuses of too busy, apathy, the inability to care anymore. I just don't care. God has called you to be an overcomer. It's a promise. It's something he offers to every born again Christian. And I'll tell you what, it's sure worth having. The victory is worth having because the world is not going to give you any true victories. Everything you seek for in the world is one day going to disappoint you. Jesus will never disappoint you. In Ephesians 2:13, it says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ." Sometimes you are so close you can almost touch it, but you can't. It's important in the journey with Christ never to quit, never to let weariness make you resign. You must fight until the very last breath. The battle is real and the foe can't always be seen with your eyes. The Holy Spirit gives you strength when there's none left. And he gives you direction when the GPS signal has long been lost. God is faithful to the end. It's important that we are also. Overcomers get past it. Victors outrun the tape at the finish line. They don't slow down before they get there. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you have called us to be overcomers. I pray, Lord, that we would capture this. I pray, God, that we would yearn for this. I pray, God, that we would enter into our prayer rooms and our closets, our moments with you, our quiet times, and we would seek after it, that we would richly pursue reality and truth, and not let this world continue to lie to us. Father, I pray that we would resist the lies of the evil one who accuses us day and night. Father, and that we would stand in the life that you have truly given us, the overcomer's life, more than conquerors. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.